Hello and welcome to Simply inTAXicating. With a flurry of activities which can be seen in a number of central government ministries and departments and also state governments now, it almost appears that the giant wheel of GST is all set to roll on July 1st. But the larger question is whether the industry and trade is really GST ready, whether the GST Council has done enough to earn comforts for all the different classes of taxpayers. We have four domain experts with us who are going to look into all various technical aspects, also the compliance aspect of the GST. We have Mr. K Garg, he is advisor, financial resources to the Chief Minister of Punjab. We have Mr. Narendra Madan, representing the Confederation of All India Traders. We have Mr. Anil Bhardwaj from FISME, and we have Mr. V. Sivasubramanian, Director of Lakshmikumaran, Sridharan. So let me start with Mr. Bhardwaj. Please explain briefly what are the key issues which have been already articulated to you, representing the Federation of huge number, millions of small, tiny, medium and micro enterprises. So what are the concerns which have been articulated to you?
See, MSME sector is looking at the 1st July, the date of rollout of GST, with trepidation and expectations. Expectations that, you know, in particularly in the manufacturing sector, they feel that, you know, they will have a higher barrier for imports and there is a greater chance of competitiveness. But at the same time, what is becoming little nightmarish for them is the complexities that GST is little unfolding as the day is approaching. And I think I would divide these two problems, one related to the conceptual part of GST as was envisaged earlier, and then as we are moving towards the final date, we are seeing increased and sustained dilution on that part. And the second part is operational. On the operational side, I guess when such a complex and large tax management system like GST is being unfolded, I would say that it is not possible for any government or any agency to presuppose all the problems and find the solutions. Sure. Also. But at the same time, some of the problems that MSME sector is experiencing is related to, I think, that the system is not fully ready. The question they are
system
posing
to system in GST network or their own system?
No, the GST network system.
Okay.
And the kind of questions they are posing, they are not getting the answers. Mm-hmm. And they are not, even for example, Ask GST, a good exercise was Twitter service has been launched. And I know personally that hundreds of my members have posed these questions, but they didn't get the answer. Okay. So the answers that you get are of the nature, what is GST, simplistic thing that are available on the net. But specific my product chain related questions are not answered. So there is silence. The silence could be because of two reasons. First of all, the department might not have the clarity on its own.
Right.
And secondly, they might be avoiding this, telling in black and white, because it would constitute to be as an advanced ruling later on.
Right.
In the court. So, but the fact of the matter then is that, you know, it makes my life a little more difficult. So initially, I think as an opening statement, I find that, you know, there are some problem in the conceptual part and some operational part.
What about traders, Mr. Madan?
मेरा ऐसा मानना है कि जो जीएसटी का सिस्टम है ये तीन बातों पे डिपेंड करता है, कम्प्लीटली, करेक्टली और टाइमली. करेक्टली नहीं किया तो भी हम पकड़े जाएंगे, क्योंकि ये सारी की सारी चीज़ें, जैसे आप समझ रहे हैं कि आज तक जो हम करते आए, एक्सटेंशन ऑफ डेट्स है या कोई भी हम ले लें, प्रोसीजरल कुछ भी चेंज नहीं है. आज 10 तारीख अगर फाइनल है तो फाइनल है, 1 से 10 तक जो काम होना है वो होना ही है. पहले क्या होता था कि हम लोग जैसे ट्रेडर्स की बात करें तो 60% से ज्यादा लोगों के पास कंप्यूटर नहीं है, और इस कानून को अगर हमने ईमानदारी से इसकी पालना करनी है तो हमारे लिए कंप्यूटर मस्ट है. अगर सिस्टम में नहीं आएंगे तो तब तक हम लोग ये नहीं कर पाएंगे.
उनकी टर्नओवर इतनी है कि जीएसटी के नेट में आएंगे,
करेक्ट,
बट उनके पास वो आईटी सेविंग नहीं
है. आईटी सेविंग नहीं है अभी तक, वो नहीं है, क्योंकि अगर हम ये देखें तो अभी भी हमारे यहाँ जो हमारी यंग जनरेशन है या हमारी जो नेक्स्ट जनरेशन है, वो 10% से ज्यादा अभी दुकानों पे या हम लोगों के इंस्टीट्यूशंस पे आनी शुरू नहीं हुई है. हमें अगर उनको लाना है तो हम भी जानते थे, और जिन लोगों के 10% जिनकी मैं बात कर रहा हूँ, अगर वो आए भी हैं तो वो इसीलिए आए हैं कि वो लोग अपग्रेड हो गए, वो कंप्यूटराइजेशन पे आ गए. बट अबाउट 90% की प्रॉब्लम वही है कि कंप्यूटर नहीं है. पहले तो सरकार को ये देखना चाहिए था, या देखा ही होगा शायद, उन्होंने रोड मैप तैयार किया होगा कि उनके लिए उन्होंने क्या सोचा है, नंबर एक। दूसरा ये है कि मैं ये मानता हूं कि अगर इसको ऑनेस्टली अप्लाई करना है तो इसकी इंप्लीमेंटेशन के लिए सबसे पहली बात यह कि डे वन से हमें ऑनेस्ट होना पड़ेगा। डे वन से ऑनेस्ट होने के लिए अभी आपने जैसे एक एक रूल लगाया कि एक साल से पहले का जो स्टॉक है उस पर आप इनपुट नहीं दे रहे हैं। आज जो सिचुएशन 60-70 साल या 40 साल या 20 साल से दुकान एक लगा के बैठा है, होलसेल का ट्रेड करता है, उसके पास कितने ऐसे स्टॉक हैं जो ओवर द पीरियड पड़े हुए हैं। जैसे मैं अगर अपनी बात करूं, मैं ऑटोमोबाइल में डील करता हूं, आज भी मेरे यहां स्टैंडर्ड 10, हेरल्ड, एम्बेसडर, फिएट, इवन मारुति 800 भी अब स्क्रैप आउट ही हो गई। वो जो सामान है आज मान लीजिए जो मैंने 100 रुपए का खरीदा, आज अगर मैं उसको बेचने जाता हूं तो कोई खरीदने वाला नहीं है। मैं अगर स्क्रैप में बेचता हूं तो मुझे उसके 10 रुपए भी नहीं मिलते हैं। तो मैं उम्मीद करता हूं कि कभी कोई एक भी कस्टमर आ गया तो मेरे 10-20 के पैसे मेरे घर में आ जाते हैं, या मैंने अगर उसको रखा हुआ है तो ये मान के रखा हुआ कि ये मेरा प्रॉफिट है, एसेट्स है मेरे, मेरे घर में पड़े हुए हैं, जब भी कोई कस्टमर आएगा मैं बेच दूंगा और मुझे मिल जाएगा। लेकिन अब मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि वो जो एसेट्स या मेरा प्रॉफिट जो मेरे पास था वो मेरे लिए सबसे बड़ा लॉस है। आज उस स्टॉक का क्या होगा, नंबर एक। आज हम तो ये भी कहते हैं कि एक ऐसी एमनेस्टी स्कीम आनी चाहिए कि जो स्टॉक तो हमने, ठीक है आपने जो भी पीरियड दिया, हमें उसमें कोई एतराज नहीं है। आज गवर्नमेंट एक रोड मैप बनाया कि एक साल का कुछ भी सोच के क्या होगा, बहुत अच्छे से किया होगा, हम वहां पर भी हैप्पी हैं। लेकिन आज जो एग्जिस्टिंग स्टॉक है जो हमारे पास रखा हुआ है उसके लिए कोई ना कोई एक मेथड जरूर बन के आना चाहिए, नंबर एक। वो नहीं भी होता है, मान लीजिए उसके लिए कोई भी हमें इंसेंटिव या आईटीसी नहीं मिलता है, तो भी एक ऐसी एमनेस्टी स्कीम होनी चाहिए कि हम वो एक लिस्ट गवर्नमेंट को दे दें, उसके लिए पूछा नहीं जाना चाहिए कि आज आप देखिए एक एक बिजनेस मैं 40-50 साल से कर रहा हूं तो मेरे पास कितनी आइटम ऐसी होती हैं। और हम लोग मैनुअल अकाउंट्स करने वाले थे, जो मैनुअल अकाउंट्स करता है तो उतना परफेक्ट नहीं हो सकता, आज कंप्यूटर से जो करता है वो एकदम परफेक्ट है। आज कंप्यूटर इसके लिए, इसीलिए मैं मस्ट कह रहा था कि भी करेक्टली करना है और टाइमली करना है और कंप्लीटली करना है, तो उसके लिए कंप्यूटर मस्ट है। क्योंकि अगर मैं मैनुअल करूंगा तो मैं कभी भी कंप्लीट भी नहीं हो सकता, करेक्ट भी नहीं हो सकता और टाइमली भी नहीं हो सकता, कहीं ना कहीं कुछ ना कुछ बाकी रह जाता है। मान लीजिए मेरा ह्यूमन एरर रहती है, आज मेरा अकाउंटेंट ही बीमार हो गया, उसके घर में शादी आ गई, तो कहीं ना कहीं मेरे पास कोई ना कोई लैप्स रहता है तो वो मुझे छूट जाता है। दूसरा ये आ जाता है कि हम कंप्यूटराइज हो भी गए तो आज तक हमें जो HSN कोड जिसकी बात करते हैं उसके बारे में गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से भी मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि ऑफिशियली नहीं आया है। और इतनी आइटम्स हैं, आप देखिए अब तक तो वो चैप्टर वाइज कोड चलते थे, उसमें कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता, अब तो आगे आइटम वाइज आएगा। अगर वो आइटम वाइज आएगा तो कब आएगा और हमें कब पता चलेगा? और आप ये देखिए कि डिस्पैरिटीज, मैं कहता हूं टैक्स की छोड़िए, रेट्स की इतनी होती है। एक ही प्रोडक्ट आज मान लीजिए एक कप है, 2 रुपए का भी मिलता है और 200 रुपए का भी मिलता है, तो आपने कोड तो एक ही कर दिया।
I got the point, sir. I mean, he has raised a couple of very valid points. One is that computerization part, sir. Do you think, sir, that do you see a role for the state government where state could perhaps assist them either in terms of interest subvention or in terms of any other scheme whereby they could be quickly, or somebody could assist them in terms of monitoring, implementation of computerization or something? Because ultimately, of course, the center and the state, now they have to work as two partners together. And there can be some schemes, sir, where the traders could be assisted, because ultimately they represent a huge chunk of the taxpayers.
See, my understanding is that GST network has already, as you know, announced GST Suvidha providers.
Right,
34
sir.
Are already provided.
Right, sir.
50 more are likely to be further authorized in that. Each of these persons has got huge competencies in IT resources, and many of them will come out with their services either completely free of cost or at a nominal price across the GST network. I think there is a certain amount of alarm and concern already arising because this date of deadline is coming very close.
Right.
So I think you give government a little time. Government is extremely conscious of the burden of GST that is being done on the small and medium enterprises.
Right, sir.
And you will get to see that this will be very much in place.
Right, sir. Mr. Subramanian, what about your, he's suggesting that for old stock, there is absolutely no ITC, nothing. So, what could be the way out? Because now he says that he has a stock for, let's say, 20 years, there could be people having a stock for 5 to 10 years.
Okay. The transition provision, I'm sure, is a major concern because none of them would have, for example, many of them would not have the duty paying documents. what happens to that? Like there is a deemed credit provision of only 40% when I pay my output, you know, tax on the output supplies. The other one is I'm going to put a cap of, you know, 1 year, you know, beyond which there is going to be no credit available. I'm sure they're all duty paid. So I'm sure that there have been representations. I'm quite aware as far as the government is concerned. I think it's a policy call. What the government needs to understand at this point of time is that while, you know, once the GST stabilizes, there is going to be some kind of a moderation in prices because, you know, the net of it, the policy has been that, you know, will not have a net impact which is higher than what is the current incidence of taxation. During the transition period, the chances of, because of various procedural issues and transition issues, the chances of people missing out on the, you know, the input credit is going to be significantly high. Maybe that is one point where I think they need to come up with some innovative scheme where they say that, yes, based on the existing rates or otherwise, they need to kind of give some deeming provision, which is not as a proportion of the final, even in excise and all, we used to have a deeming deemed credit scheme. So maybe a deemed credit scheme which could actually apply, you know, that kind of an innovative scheme is something which they should perhaps think of. Otherwise, it's going to be a major issue, at least for the transition period. We are going to have, at least for the next 3 months or so, where there is going to be maybe even a significant price spike. So I think government should come up with some policy issues.
So Mr. Bhardwaj, how serious or the severe this the credit blow is going to be during the transition provision? The 40% which has been hiked to 60% now for those goods which attract more than 18% tax rate and 40% for less than 18%. But now issue is how much damage is going to be done to the working capital for small and medium enterprises particularly?
Well, I mean, the precise extent is very difficult to say at this moment.
But this bill.
But the fear is that it is going to be substantive. And I mean, one of the major issues that has been raised is by the exporters who are saying that their large chunk of their working capital is going to get stuck because although the minister has ensured or assured that, you know, that the payments would be made or refund would be made within 7 days, but 7 days from the date of shipment. So, but what happens, I buy certain products now, I process them for 1 month, maybe even sometimes more, and then I export, it takes time. If you are sitting, for example, in a landlocked state like Punjab or Delhi, it would take another 15 days for the goods to reach to the port and then uploading on the ship. So if you look at the entire period when the duty paid goods are in process or in transition, so that is going to take away a large chunk of their working capital. And that is going to be a major difficulty that exporters are facing. That may have the detrimental impact on the cost of export also. And keeping in view that SMEs have major problems on working capital loan, in getting their working capital financed. So in spite of a lot of committees, you know, NIAC committee report and et cetera, but working capital is one major area for the MSME sector. So yes, I think one of the major concerns is about work impact of credit on the working capital side.
Sir, you enjoy a very unique position. I mean, you have seen the government side, being the joint secretary TRU, you have made the law, you have seen the implementation side, you have also seen the other side. Now as an advisor to the state government and lots of representations reaching you. So what could be the way out? You know, this 40% the credit, 60% credit during the transition period, a lot of fund going to be locked and where the industry and trade have a concern.
First of all, let me tell you the factual position. The credit is 100% if you have a duty-paying document.
Document, right.
Now, in most of the states, the VAT, as you know, has been operative from 2005. And therefore, if somebody was lawfully doing a business, he would have a document. And for an unlawful business, even today, there is no credit. Because this 40 and 60 also is if you have a document.
Right.
Therefore, the problem is confined to very few states, like Punjab is definitely one of the states, where the levy of VAT for many commodity was first point levy, as they call it.
Right.
So, you collected from point one, but there was no tax on point two or point three. You understand? This is not a situation in majority of the states, in fact, predominantly nearly all the states except Punjab, maybe one or two more. So, I think this alarm that is getting created that they will not get full credit is definitely a concern for a state like Punjab. It's not there for a lot of other concerns. However, on the central excise, which was always a first point levy, there was no tax, no excise on the subsequent this thing. I think that is a matter of concern more for the central excise rather than the VAT.
VAT side, right, sir, correct. Absolutely. This is what he was also articulating, the central excise.
Personally, if you ask me, I would have liked to see a higher credit. Let's not forget that excise was a tax on manufacture and it was a tax on the factory gate value. And if it was MRP, certain amounts of abatements were being given. Now, when you move to a GST system, you are also trying to tax the value addition by the wholesaler and retailer. So, therefore, they couldn't be given 100% credit. Whatever value they add, the tax was required to be done. Now, a lot of abatements are 30%, 40%.
Right.
Now, if you are saying abatement was 40, 60 you have taxed.
Right.
40 you feel need to be taxed now. One can argue whether 40 should be 60 or 70 and something like that.
Right.
But the law is very close to the rates of abatement. I don't know a single abatement which was less than 70.
Right, correct.
I don't know.
Yeah, most of the items, yes.
In fact, there are abatements, 50 also, 45 also. So, probably the number was somewhere between 60 and 70. 60 government has agreed.
Right. 60 government has agreed. So, more government is very close to that.
Close to that.
Very close.
So now, the problem therefore is confined to a state like Punjab, where there was a first point levy and there was a tax close to 16% at the first point. And now, let's say if you are in a 9% SGST, you will get 9 into 0.6, only 5.4,
yes,
whereas you have paid a very substantial tax,
yes,
on that.
Right. That will be.
That looks to be.
Yeah. Yeah, a little unfair. Yeah. Mr. Bhardwaj, what about the reverse charge side? I mean, you have seen the provision, you have seen how if a large, you
know, I think it would be Mr. Garg to articulate,
okay,
it rather.
Yes, sir. Maybe you would like to articulate it. So the reverse charge side, you know, the what has been proposed, where a lot of compliance burden has been, you know, put on the large manufacturers who are going to source goods from unregistered suppliers. So, how exactly this matrix is going to work, sir?
Before I comment on that, you know, you must also contextualize the GST discussion in a larger context. If a country is trying to move from one method of paying taxes to another method of paying taxes, then one has to see that there are some advantages. For example, GST is likely to improve the compliance for the economy as a whole. And everyone should hope that in due course, government will pass on the benefits of improved compliances to finally the consumers. The rates of taxes should come down. We are a very highly taxed economy. So every time you ask for a compliance, there is a trade-off. There is a burden on somebody and there is a possibility of bringing down the tax rate in the due concern. Whether this kind of a compliance is desirable, ask me. I'm a little concerned myself, because what basically you are telling is that if you buy something from an unregistered buyer, and this is not all the kind of small scale goes up to any extent, but if you are buying it from an unregistered person, and people are going to be unregistered if they are below 20 lakhs, then the compliance burden has been shifted on the other side.
Right.
No, it's possible that many times the big guy will say, why buy it from him and have the burden of paying the taxes on that side. I think a good via media would be that you prescribe a bare minimum limit. See, otherwise, if you order a cup of tea from the street vendor, you are required to make an invoice and then pay a certain amount of GST on that. I would say if the invoice is more than, let's say, 5,000 rupees or even a higher one, let's say 10,000 rupees or something like that, then you shift the burden, then let's get 90% or very, very small purchases out of the system.
Right.
I'm definitely going to make this suggestion and I hope that this burden is removed.
Now, Mr. Sivasubramanian, do you agree with sir? What is the way out for this? You know, the example like this, that you know, any large corporation or anybody who is in the business of business will be naturally sourcing a few items from very small vendors and that becomes a supply. And going over the reverse charge provisions, the burden rests with the large corporation.
Okay. See, let's look at two parts to this. Whether what is there in the law was the original intention is one thing which I would like to kind of flag. Perhaps in case the other party has not paid, but please understand, it is only if it is liable to be paid. If any case I am within that, the threshold limit, I don't need to pay. Okay, so that's one kind of a way you take. It is not a taxable supply which I am making. I was not in any case required to be registered and I was not required to pay. So one way to look at it maybe is that the person was liable to pay, he did not pay, but I am shifting the burden onto somebody else and therefore, you know, I will at least collect the money. Whether I can enforce it later on, etc., is one issue we'll have to see because now you shifted the burden. So now, what was the intention behind this particular reverse charge itself is one issue. Yes, one way to look at it, yes, right from zero, everything is shifted. That means there is an incentive that I don't need to even register myself, right? Even if I don't register, even beyond 20 lakhs, because you're going to collect it from the other party, the entire burden shifts onto them. So why is it that you want me to register? This kind of, I'm sure we're going to have these kind of questions of law. So the intention perhaps was only to say if it was a taxable supply which was liable to pay tax, then only the other party is being made to pay, notwithstanding the fact that I can proceed against the other party for not having registered. But the question is that the way it is worded as of now, it would look as if that even if Mr. Garg was saying, it's like even if I buy a cup of coffee elsewhere, I had to raise an invoice and make a payment. I think that's where the whole issue comes down, that the intention somewhere should have been very clear, that it should have been a taxable supply, liable for payment of taxes. I can still go and proceed against that person for not having registered and paid, but in order not to lose the revenue, I'm collecting it from the other party, which is the receiver, right? So if this kind, this clarification or, adequate kind of legislative or, clarificatory mechanism is enforced, then perhaps you'd still have, maybe it's not a threshold in terms of an invoice, but at least a threshold in terms of that, yes, the supply should have been taxable right at the beginning. So this is what I would look at it.
On this note, let me thank all my guests and the key insights which they have been able to articulate for the policymakers is that GST network continues to be a major area of concern, not only for the SMEs, but for all classes of taxpayers. Secondly, so far as traders are concerned, the old stocks, naturally, a very serious and big problem for them. And they strongly believe the solution lies in introducing some sort of amnesty scheme for the traders. Like the central excise, the dimmed credit perhaps could be explored as one of the options during the transition phase. However, the credit is not a very serious issue for all the states, but maybe a state like Punjab perhaps. So there are certain issues which have been rightly articulated, concerns expressed for the policymakers, for the GST Council. Let us hope the GST Council and the central government and all the states take note of them and do something for giving some sort of relief to the taxpayers. Thanking you all for watching TILTU and stay tuned for our next episode where we are going to talk about with the same set of panel whether it should be July 1st or September 1st. What are the merits and what are the demerits? Thanking you all for watching TILTU.